On behalf of the Cruising Association and Practical Boat Owner Magazine, we are delighted to welcome a sailor who needs little introduction. Jeanne Socrates has broken numerous records, including sailing 4.5 times around the world, twice non-stop. She is also the first woman to sail solo, unassisted and non-stop around the world from North America. Jeanne's latest adventure began in April 2023, sailing solo from Mexico across the Pacific to New Zealand and onto Australia aboard her Najad 380 Nereida. Aged 81, Jeanne shares her unique insights on cruising and solo sailing with us. Jeanne.
Okay, well, it's very much my pleasure to be here. It's delightful to be at the boat show, even though I'm not personally there, but virtually. Okay.
So, Jeanne, you've been 4.5 times around the world. How do you prepare for a long trip mentally?
Well, to be honest, I don't feel as though I have to do any great mental preparations, because the fact that I've done all the practical preparations is what enables me to feel happy that I'm on a safe boat, and that everything will go well. You know, I've obviously had a look at the weather to be expected on as I go around the world at different times of the year, and obviously I've got my boat well prepared, and I'm always saying to people, you know, if you've got a good boat and you've prepared her well, you can kind of relax, because you know that you're ready for anything, and that's what really matters.
So how do you prepare your boat for the Pacific Ocean voyage, especially as the boat has already done several circumnavigations? What are the differences?
Oh, right. Okay. Well, the difference basically is that this is a cruising style ship that I'm on. It's so, so different from me trying to empty the boat of everything to go around the world. I mean, the last time I left so much stuff with people in Victoria and Vancouver and other places. And then suddenly I've got it back, because here I've got a dinghy, I've got an outboard, I've got so much stuff that I didn't need for a non-stop attempt. And I'm living in all this stuff, and some of it I'd left it for so long, 6 years I'd left it with people, because of my reattempting to try and do what I finally ended up doing, and then COVID getting in the way. So some of this stuff had been in people's basements for 6 years. I'm looking at some cushions I left behind. So totally different. And so some of it I didn't even recognize. Was that really mine? I forgot I had it. So a dinghy and outboard. What else? Oh, the fridge. Yeah, of course, I turned the fridge off for my nonstop attempts. Because what do I want a fridge for? You know, treated as a dry locker. So, yeah, very, very different getting this boat ready for cruising compared with not stopping anywhere.
And how do you keep your fitness up for a long trip?
With difficulty. I do actually go use my companionway steps as for stepping up and down when I remember to do it. I try and do that a bit, get my leg action. Obviously, I am winching. It's not completely without its exercise. But the thing is, I think also, I once pulled my calf muscle, and the physio said to me when she heard I was on a boat, "Oh, well, that's fine," she said, "don't worry about things, you know, everything will be fine," because of course the boat is forever moving. And especially if you're down in the Southern Ocean, there's constantly movement. It's a rarity when the boat is in a flat calm. So in a way, just trying to get up Mount Everest to get over the other side of the cabin to get to the loo is something quite effective. You know, you're moving, you're working your body a lot. So despite that, my arms did. I didn't weigh myself when I got back last time. I was really quite annoyed because I had clearly lost a lot of weight. And one does, you know, you hear so always of people that have lost weight and lost muscle, whatever. So, I've got elastibands, actually. I've got some here, a whole collection of them that mean I'm going to try and do my arm exercise a bit more often. And the intention's there, but it often doesn't happen.
And have you had to adapt kind of your cruising style and the way you sail at longer distances as you've got older?
No, not at all. I don't think it's made any difference whatsoever. You're either going to go and be able to sail or you're not. That's it.
And how have you done adaptations and modifications on board for solo sailing?
No different really from shorthanded sailing, which a lot of other people do. My preventers are very easy to put in place. I've got a little bit of a line on the end of the boom on both sides, so I've got preventers on both sides, which actually comes quite handy even when you're going upwind and you're in a big swell and the wind dies, as it were. It's quite handy to have those two preventers to hold the boom in place, and I bring my lines. Most of my lines are back to the cockpit. I have twin line reefing, so I've got quite a few lines for the reefing lines. But occasionally, I have to go forward. Things get twiddled, something happens, I have to go forward. But most of the time, I am in the safety of the cockpit doing things. As I say, that's really quite similar to normal shorthanded.
So how has your boat been adapted over the years since you became a full-time cruiser?
Really, again, because as a long-term cruiser, no different. It's a sailing boat, so I'm not going to do anything. I'm not going to make her look any different, as I'm not moving the boat. I'm sailing the boat so frequently that you have to keep the boat in good trim for that.
And you are, I mean, your last circumnavigation that you did, you had to repair an awful lot of breakages and electrical problems and equipment failure. What for you is the most useful tool in your toolbox?
This one I always refer to. It's my long copper pipe. It's not that long. It's about 12 inches. It just gives me more of an extension, so that when I need to move something, I've got better leverage. I've got a lever, a longer lever, and double the lever, you double the force. So yeah, it's been my a saving so many times for me. It's one of the things I'm always looking for in my tool bag.
And you've obviously done years of solo sailing. What are some of the key lessons you've learnt over the years?
Very, very important when I was going to say it anyway, when something hits the fan, to stay calm and maybe if it's I remember when I got knocked out of Cape Horn, I had to prioritize, and it was so difficult because actually one or two things seem to be always top of the list, but you have to prioritize, stay calm, and just have enough stuff for spares and tools and bits and pieces. That however you're going to do it, you're going to get through, you will manage. Having a confidence that you can just stay calm, think about things, and you will manage to get through.
And how do you stay calm in a situation like that?
Oh, you just have to. You've got to cross your any emotion. When I lost my boat, I had to stay calm and not think about how upset I was at losing my boat, my teammate. Staying calm is absolutely essential, and if you stay calm, you can focus. You can sort out what you have to do. This has to happen. There's no, I don't know. I don't know how I do it. I just know that I've got to stay calm. That's it.
And how do you cope with being alone on your boat for a long time?
But I have to say, the radio is such an amazing thing here, because without the radio, I wouldn't be able to chat to people. You hear so many stories of people hallucinating and going mad, and there's just no question of that, either of those happening for me, because I'm on the radio. My last time going around, every day I was on the radio, sometimes more than once, several times a day. I could have been on the radio a lot around Australia. Kept being offered to go, oh, go over to Sydney, go over to Adelaide, and they've got a net going. So I think the radio for me has become more and more important the more I've gone around. And on the non-stop especially.
Do you think if could you do something like the Golden Globe race where you've got quite limited communication, although you have got access to HF radio? Do you think that's something you could do?
Pleased to hear that they do, because at one time they were talking about banning it because of the weather problem, the positioning problem. But since I hear they have got it, I'd be fine, because I'd be able to talk to my friends around the globe. As I'm going, it was lovely to go, as I'm coming around South America, I'm coming down towards the Horn, I'm talking to the Chileans, and then coming up, I'm talking up to the talking to the Argentinians and the Brazilians. It was brilliant, really lovely. And they got to know that I was coming up at this time, and they'd come back, and I'd hear the same people day after day coming to chat to me. It's really lovely.
And are all these interactions in English, or do you know lots of different languages?
Mostly in English, but it did give me a chance of bad Spanish as I went around South America, which I like.
That's great. That's amazing. And what do you consider the most resourceful solution that you've come up with to fix something on board?
Well, I think the most urgent thing that I had to fix in a bit of a hurry was when I got a hole in my cabin roof. I'm looking over to the port side settee that I was sitting on, and when suddenly I got drenched in water because my derard, my vent had been torn away. And I just had to, you know, but I have bits of wood, I have bits of plastic, I have all these bits and pieces. I have so many, you know, you look at them and think, well, when are you going to use those? You have no idea what breakage you're going to need to repair. So you have all these things. I remember actually one time my stove came off its gimbals, and that tried to walk across, you know, well, if I hadn't had lots of bits of string and wood, well, wood more than the string, obviously, but bits of wood to wedge it in place and then tie it, lash it down, I would have been in big trouble. So in that event, I had to, when I had the hole in the cabin roof, obviously fairly quickly, I had to get out there and cover it temporarily with wood. And then I found a long bolt, coach bolt, that I had on board. So yeah, you have to have a lot of different things ready for as and when whatever it would be happened. You don't know what it's going to be, you know, when. You just know that all the time breakage is going to happen, you have to fix them.
And how do you go about approaching a problem at sea?
But again, you've got to make sure you stay calm for a start, otherwise you can't think straight. But if it's a mechanical type of problem, then obviously, you know, I often say if I can see how it's broken, then I can stand the chance of fixing it. Electronic ones, yeah, hopefully you've got a backup, but an electrical, I have lots and lots of spares, you know, for joining up bits of wire and pumps and 12 volt connections and so on. I think it's just a matter of if there's a way, I'm sure I can find it, just stay calm, think about it. We've got to be able to fix this. You know, I think you have to have a fair amount of confidence that yes, you have got enough stuff on board that somehow or other it will happen and you will find a way to fix it. Might not be the way that it should be, but it doesn't matter. As long as it works, it works.
So you're a real true practical boat owner then?
Absolutely, yes.
Your background teaching, do you think that has helped you develop how you approach problem solving?
I think probably more the fact that I'm a mathematician, and you know, I have physics as well, so they've given me a logical, you know, I've got a fairly logical turn of mind. I think that's probably very helpful.
And I imagine that comes into play when you're trying to solve challenges on long solo voyages.
Well, on any voyage, right, solo or otherwise, you've got a problem, especially if it's rough and you've got to get this thing sorted out. Somehow it's got to happen. You're just going to think, okay, there's got to be a way around the problem. I've just got to find it. And if the first answer doesn't always work as well as you'd like it to, you often think up a better way, you know, as you happening. I mean, chafe, for instance, is often a problem. So you fix something and you suddenly realise it's chafing like mad. You've got to find a way around that problem. And that's where my bits and pieces come on handy, because I know I've cut up a little one of these little thin PTFE chopping boards, and they've been really handy. You know, you can cut those with scissors and they've been really good for anti-chafe on board.
Oh, that's clever. So how do you fix them round? You just bend them round to fit, do you?
Yeah, put them in place over the chafe point, and then lots of lashing with twine or whatever, rope, you know, depending on the size. In fact, that's what I did when I had my, my rod kicker came away from the mast, all 12 rivets suddenly broke. I couldn't believe it. I tried to get that fixed. I tried to lash it to the mast, but then I suddenly found that, yeah, I had the rivets were getting, I couldn't quite get them out of the way. And then it was, I'd lashed it to the mast, and then that lashing was catching on something. But then I cut a big piece of this kind of little thin chopping board put it behind and lash that in place. So that worked quite well, actually. I just had to keep an eye on it because it kept trying to move in the big seas. So every day, my list of things to check.
During your circumnavigations, you face numerous challenges. What has been the most significant challenge that you've faced at sea?
Well, my first big knockdown off Cape Horn, because so much was broken, the boom and the washboard and the just so many things. And there it was partly because I just had to get up on deck. I mean, my stays was flogging. I thought the rig was going to come down. There's this almost horrible, knocking of the stays off flogging. And I had to get out and deal with things, but I was still expecting another knockdown because I couldn't see any reason why I shouldn't be. The situation hadn't really changed much, so that was quite worrying. Again, the hole in the cabin roof in the Southern Ocean wasn't exactly good. That was a bit of a worry. And then I think also one big challenge was, of course, repairing my staysail in the Southern Ocean. I mean, that's another world record that I have that no one's going to want, getting around the Southern Ocean most of the way with a non-working mainsail, because I'm trying desperately to repair it on the deck because I couldn't get it down below to repair it there. That was an ongoing challenge. Yeah, also helped make my voyage very much longer.
Yes, because it was 339 days, if I remember correctly. Yeah,
horrendous.
Yeah. So how did you fix that mainsail in the end?
Well, I had to get out on deck and look for calm weather. I mean, it's another reason why I slowed down, because I was looking for calm weather rather than good wind and big seas to get going, because I had to be on deck stitching that sail on the boom on the highest point pretty well on the deck you can find. You know, so I've got any swell, it was becoming almost impossible to do anything. So that was really, yeah, it took an age. I mean, every stitch I had to be down. So every time I wanted to come back up through the sail, I had to turn the sail around to come back down through the sail in order to finish off that stitch. It was it was terribly, terribly slow, and I just couldn't. I just had to, in a way, stop looking at how many days I was taking to get through the Southern Ocean. It was just so long, I couldn't believe it.
I guess you need to kind of forget about how long it takes you and just focus on getting to the destination.
Right, yeah, I was saying each day at a time, or where's the next cape, let's have a party, let's try and, enjoy ourselves at some point in time on a regular basis.
And what kind of valuable life lessons have you learned through your sailing experiences?
Well, I think the staying calm thing is really important. And the other thing was also realizing, if there's a problem, there's got to be a way. Often, not always, but 99% of the time, you can generally find a way of overcoming a challenge. You just have to find a way and fight your way through it, maybe. Have confidence that if you persevere and are determined enough, if you won't give up, you will find a way around it, a given problem.
And we've talked about your 4.5 circumnavigations, all the challenges you faced. Would you do another solo and non-stop circumnavigation of the world?
Well, I'm not sure that I'm going to go for another non-stop, but everyone now that I'm on my present trip, they're saying to me, is this your fifth circumnavigation, Lauren? I'm not thinking about specifically doing one, but I might end up having done one. I'm just really into maybe cruising around, seeing places that I'd skipped last time or missed, like New Zealand, I hadn't really stopped in. So just enjoying myself. And it's been wonderful to see. You make so many friends when you're cruising around. You meet up with people you don't know. You meet up with people you do know again, maybe a year or two later. It's just fantastic.
And how, when you're on kind of long passage, how do you manage your sleep and rest times?
It gets better. I notice at the start that I am really having to sleep a lot in the mornings during the day to make up for lost sleep overnight. But as you get on underway, quite quickly, actually, you fall back into a routine of getting very good at dropping off to sleep when you lie down. I remember when I had my first baby, they held relaxation classes for the mothers. And that has been such a brilliant thing because I can totally relax and go off to sleep now. You know, my husband would complain because I was breastfeeding the baby. I'd come back to bed and I go to sleep almost immediately. There he was trying to get to sleep still. So he had a problem. I didn't. So that's been a wonderful resource to be able to relax and go down to sleep very quickly. And a good alarm is the other thing. You can't go to sleep if you know you're not going to wake up when you want to. So, you know, whatever the alarm has been set for, I know I'm going to wake up to that. And if the boat changes, if the motion of the boat changes before the alarm goes off, something's happened, you wake up and you know you've got to deal with it. So, yeah, it's an alarm is a good thing to have, though.
Preferably imagine...
one you've got to get up out of your bunk to get to.
I imagine because you're so attuned to your boat now, you must feel every time there's anything slightly not right, you're automatically aware of that.
Yeah, well, it's funny because as I was coming down to Tahiti from the Tuamotus, just 2-day passage and relatively calm, I'd gone down for a nap at one point and suddenly I woke up because the wind had got up a little bit. And instead of going along at about 3.5 knots, we were making 5 knots. It wasn't that much, but I did feel the motion of the boat changed. So something had changed. It wasn't much, but it did wake me up, even that little change in the wind.
And obviously you've done an awful lot sailing in your sailing life. What was your proudest moment so far?
It's a little bit of a difficult one. I was very exhilarated when I got round my fifth Cape in May of 2019, because with all the difficulties, I mean, I was having to stitch my mainsail. I still hadn't got my mainsail back up, actually. I'd got despite it all, and that really felt wonderful. I'd actually tacked and delayed my going around Stewart Island to be there at dawn because I was going to go around in night, and I thought, no, damn it, I want to be around in the daytime. I want to see this fifth Cape. I've had so much trouble getting around, you know. And of course, this was despite having just had a bad knockdown as well, because I'd been delayed so much. I was getting into winter weather, and it was feeling quite horrible. And so I'd had a big knockdown. I was still trying to get my mainsail, and despite that, I'd managed to get round. And that was, yeah, that felt pretty wonderful. I was so exhilarated. Had a wonderful sail the next day in the lee of Stewart Island. It was wonderful.
Wow, amazing. What do you miss most when you're at sea?
I always answer usually with a crispy, crunchy Caesar salad. Fresh salad, fresh, crunchy greens and vegetables, yeah.
Well, talking about food, Victor, for a long passage, and kind of what's your favourite onboard treat to keep you going?
Oh, the favourite, that's an easy one, because I'm a chocoholic, so I make sure I've got little bars of chocolate or little bit, you know, I have to put them away somewhere to make it a little bit difficult to get there. Do you really want your chocolate? Yeah, I do. I want to get there. I've got to get down to it. But the provisioning, what I do is I set out, knowing the kind of food that I'm going to likely to have on board, I'll set out a 2-week menu, one with eggs, because of course my eggs churned every day will last me 4 months if I get them fresh from the hen, and one without eggs, and so I and then I multiply out. So I literally have a little weighing scales, and I weigh my whatever and know exactly how much I need to multiply out, how much I'm going to want, and then I keep adding in a bit more and a bit more of this, and oh, that's a good idea, a bit more of that. So I will never run out of food when I'm on a, even though it was a lot longer than expected. I mean, that took 11 months when I thought I was going to go quicker than the first time and take 7 months. I still had enough food. I'm a cruiser at heart, basically.
And how do you transition to being back on land when you've been on passage for months and months?
It's funny, it's almost like a switch, you know, you just switch to online mode. I do wobble a bit for the first day or two, I've noticed, but other than that, yeah, you're just back on land. It's just so totally different. So you just slip into that mode. It's really quite, I feel a bit, you know, it's really quite a weird feeling that you just slip into. It's like coming back to London, I'm back in London mode when I'm back in London, you know, you just switch into that.
And with your current trip, what's been the best and the worst thing about your trip from Mexico to French Polynesia?
The worst part was, oh yes, I remember what that was. The because I'm back into cruising and I'm stopping in places and I'm in French Polynesia. I came through the Tuamotus, and there's a lot of coral and coral reefs and coral, what are called bommies, coral heads are called bommies. And I'm trying to get away from one particular beautiful anchorage. I'd been there for quite a few days. The wind had changed quite a bit while I was there, came up quite strongly from different directions. So I went to put up my anchor thinking I might have had a problem. And sure enough, I had my anchor was stuck around three different coral heads. Unbelievable. But fortunately, other cruisers by me were on channel 16, and I was able to put out a call on channel 16 asking if anyone could come and help me. And three guys turned up, two from Germany, one from Sweden, in their dinghies and snorkel gear, and got me. My chain was literally wrapped around one of them around 90 degrees. Without their help, I would never have got away.
The kindness of, for strangers.
Yeah, absolutely. That was wonderful. Well, it was the worst situation, the way when I realized I couldn't get away. I tried backing the boat, and, you know, going forward and back, and did whatever I could. So that was the worst. But then it became actually almost the best, because suddenly, you know, kind cruisers come to your help. So it was wonderful.
And you must see plenty of wildlife while cruising. What's been your most memorable kind of wildlife encounter?
Well, in a way, the albatrosses when you're down in the Southern Ocean, because they are so, I mean, the wandering albatross and the royal albatrosses, they are so big. You know, I always say to everyone, you know, well, think of a person, each wing is 6 foot long, and they are just so big, and they're coming by the boat, and they're looking you in the eye, and they're just mostly gliding anyway, and just wonderful to see them. And I got to see, I remember actually after my knockdown, I came from Ushuaia from Argentina, eventually across the South Atlantic over to via the Falklands over to Cape Town. And I seemed to collect a little group of birds. There were shearwaters, petrels and albatrosses. And I'm convinced that for 3 weeks I had the same birds following me. And that was wonderful. You know, you got to recognize markings on them.
Did you end up naming them?
Almost, yeah. I kind of almost got to that point, but yeah, that's pretty good. You know, the albatrosses in particular, especially the juvenile wandering albatross, which is dark black, chocolate color actually, with a white face, always reminds me a bit of a clown. I love seeing those, and they're usually with their mum and dad. You know, they stay together for quite a time, so that's pretty wonderful.
Wow. What's your favorite place to go sailing?
Oh, everywhere's so different, aren't you? Know, it's I think, you know, British Columbia takes a lot of beating. There's wonderful cruising. I'm seeing so many people now that have come straight through Panama to keep on going to French Polynesia, and saying, oh, you really should have turned right when you got through the Panama Canal to get up to Southeast Alaska, to Alaska, British Columbia, and then you've got California, that coast down there, Mexico. In particular, has so many little islands, and they're all well protected. You've got a little dinghy dock, and if the weather changes, you just go around. There's another anchorage really close by. So for cruising, British Columbia takes a lot of beating. But on the other hand, if we just say sailing, the Southern Ocean, I mean, that was partly why I did my second nonstop, because I actually wanted to get back down to the Southern Ocean with those awe-inspiring big swells. I mean, so long as they're well apart, you can just sit in the boat in the cockpit and admire the fact that, oh my God, are we really going to get over that? You know, are we going to just take that swell and not have a problem? Because they are enormous and so steep and just fantastic. So, yeah, that's somewhere that I find myself awe-inspired every time I sail in that situation.
And is there anywhere that you've not sailed to yet, which is on your wish list?
Well, I'm actually on my way to New Zealand, to the North Island, to sail there, because I've been round the bottom twice, through the middle once, around the top once, and I've never stopped in the North Island. And I keep hearing about this wonderful cruising area. So that's actually, it's on my wish list, but I'm actually getting there now, I hope. I should be there by early November sometime, via the Minerva Reef, which I really is on my wish list. I really want to go from Tonga down to New Zealand, so I actually go through via the Minerva Reef, which I really fancy stopping in. And experiencing. Sounds wonderful.
What is the reason why you want to go to the reef? Is it the wildlife? Is it the scenery?
Well, a lot of people, even people on the way to New Zealand now, haven't heard about it. But it's the I mean, they've only recently, you know, what, 10, 20 years? I'm not sure quite how long they've been known about, but that you don't see them when you're going past by sea. You don't see anything because the reefs are big atolls that are just below sea level. But they act as a protection. And so you go in inside them and you can stay there for days, weeks, whatever, because they're really big. And you don't get, in bad weather, they are a really good course to go to stay while the weather goes by and then wait for the next weather window to go on to down to New Zealand from there. So and people go snorkeling there, they catch fish while they're waiting around for the weather. I think people just go there for a bit of a holiday, you know. It's a long passage from Tonga or Fiji down to New Zealand, it's 10 days, and you invariably get bad weather at some point. So it's quite a handy place to know about.
Mm-hmm. So it sounds like quite challenging navigation. How do you plan your routes and navigation?
Well, I mean, I can do the Celestial. I have done the Celestial. I have a sextant on board and I try to keep my annual information up to date. But obviously GPS is very useful. In the days when I started learning, of course, it was all taking sights and trying to make your cockpit as small as possible. In fact, I still do have a very good hand-bearing compass and another electronic device that made my cockpit really tiny. Knowing the weather you're expecting at certain times of year, obviously you have to take weather into account, the kind of winds you're expecting. And I have good weather information. Again, if I haven't got it via an Iridium connection, then I have it via my radio, because on the SSB radio, I have a packed modem and I can download good files as and when I want to, as long as I get a radio connection. So the radio, again, has up to this point in time been very useful for getting my weather information. Most important.
You've told us about your plans to be in New Zealand by November. What other cruising plans do you have for the next 5 to 10 years?
When I was traveling Australia over the pandemic, and I must have been one of the happiest, most guilt-ridden people alive, because I was having such a beautiful time while I was there. And I actually got to do a circumnavigation by land in a camper van of Australia and got to see just about everywhere, all these wonderful places. And every now and then I was taken out on the water by someone because they knew I was there, and they're going out, oh, would you like to come on the boat? Oh, yes, please, you know, get out on the water, get my fix. I have to get on the water every now and then. So I'm really trying to get back to Australia at the moment with my boat, though, so I can actually go cruising around. There's some wonderful cruising to be had there. And depending on the time of year, you go either in the north when it's not the cyclone season, or you go down to Tasmania when it is the cyclone season. So I'm trying to get back to Australia, having gone to New Zealand in the meantime, to tick that off my wish list, if you like. And at the moment, that's as far as my plan goes. Everyone's saying, well, what's happening? I've actually met up just recently, just a week ago, amazingly, with a South African friend who happened to be tied up in a boat right next to mine from when I was in Cape Town in, I was trying to figure out when it was, 2011, 2012, some time ago. I've still got a lot of friends in South Africa that are saying, hey, are you coming our way? When are you coming back to see us? You know? So it's quite amazing. I've got friends all over the place, which is, you know, lovely to see them.
Why do you do what you do? Why do you do your circumnavigations, you know, push the envelope? What is it that keeps you wanting to go back and do it again and again?
Well, it's partly because I just love being at sea. I mean, I just love, you know, I have to get, as I just said, I have to have my fix of being back on the water at some point if I haven't been for time. I really miss being on the water if I haven't been. So I love being on the water. I love sailing. I mean, I've got so exhilarated sometimes when, you know, when you're really sailing well and the boat's, you know, just creaming along and you're making good speed and, oh, wow, you know, the boat's going so well. It's lovely. And then partly also, of course, it's been the challenge of, can I get the boat round with all the breakages that happen if I try for nonstop? I mean, I wasn't going to go, you know, there's quite a, I was being interviewed in London by ITV at one point after my first time. And, you know, and the question was like, there, you know, are you going to do another? Oh, no. not another nonstop. And then, of course, years later, because I wanted to get down to the Southern Ocean, basically, it happened again, you know. And again, it was a challenge. You know, am I going to make it? Can I go around faster? Can I make the boat work better? Am I up to it? There was that question as well. I love being at sea. And then also now, when you're meeting up with people, I mean, you meet so many wonderful people as cruisers. If you have a problem, everyone helps everyone else. You know, you help them, they help you. It's a wonderful way of life. You know, it's the way humanity should be, and unfortunately isn't mostly. And here you are getting help, making friends, seeing people. Yeah, I mean, on this trip already, I've had so many people come to help me when I've had a bit of a problem. And people I don't know, you know, you just make friends with them and they become really good friends. So it's great. I just love it.
And you're writing a book about your sailing experiences. How is progress going?
It was going quite well until a week or so back. You know, when you get moving, when you go from place to place, obviously you have to plan what you're doing, your passage making, tides and passes, and the two motors are pretty important to get right. So, just checking to see where you're going, how you're going to get there, what it involves, takes up time. So, and when I'm underway, I find I can't write anything. I can't write anything in that way. I'm writing a blog maybe, but I can't write a book. There's too much going on involved. You know, you've got to keep the sails trimmed. You've got to keep an eye on the weather. So it's ground to a bit of a halt the last week or two, but it is going not too badly. Trouble is there's just so much to write about. You know, you know, I've been around 4.5 times and there's other stuff that wasn't in any of those circumnavigations, going up and down between Alaska and Mexico, for instance, if you things have happened then, in the Caribbean or in, you know, other times. So there's rather a lot to write about. So it's coming along. I'm hoping I'll be able to concentrate on it and get it done. It should have been finished last December. So I do have a bit of a deadline trying to get things done.
So when can we expect to read it? Any ideas? End of next year, maybe?
Hopefully. It was supposed to have been ready for this September's boat show, but that isn't happening, obviously. So maybe in a year's time, boat show it might do.
Oh, I look forward to that. Thank you. You obviously blog and write about your voyages. What does it mean to you that people are following your journey?
It means a lot. It helped me a lot, I think, while I was going around for the long-term voyages, the non-stop, knowing that I was getting that support, that people were there reading and they were with me when I had problems. I'd get emails from people, from complete strangers, in fact, offering advice, you know, and on the radio again, I'd get advice offered there. And but I just knew that these people, they just wanted me to keep going and to manage it, to get there in the end. They were really rooting for me, and that was a wonderful feeling. It was as though they were in spirit with me in the boat.
Oh, that's lovely. What advice would you give to anyone starting their cruising journey?
Well, obviously, get yourself a good boat, a good sturdy one that's ready for, you know, I'm always saying to people, think the worst possible. You know, the boat could be in really, really nasty weather, could turn upside down. You never want it to, obviously, but it might happen. Are you prepared for that? Is the boat ready for that? Is it a sturdy boat? You prepared it. I mean, I know because I prepared my boat so well. That's why I can be mentally, you know, fairly relaxed. You know, I just know that if something happens, I've thought through the event and I know what I'm going to do and what, you know, what it's all about. Really important to think ahead and think of the worst possible scenarios. Hope they never happen. Just be ready for them. Is the boat set up for that? I'm often saying to people, okay. In fact, when this boat was in build, I'd go down, I'd say to the guys fitting out the boat, when the boat turns upside down, what's going to happen? You know, is this, so they put batteries in and I couldn't see any strapping. And I thought, hang on, you know, surely when we turn upside down, you're going to tell me those batteries are going to stay in place? Never. Next day, of course, you know, thick, good straps appeared. And, maybe they were going to happen anyway, but I just saw that there's no way that was going to stay. And lockers, you know, when they fly open, you can get hit by flying missiles. You can be knocked unconscious. So you just have to make sure that when you start out, you've thought about everything, the weather, you know, you're at sea, something happens. You meet up with a ship. Do you know the colleagues? A lot of people seem to be unaware of that. that I've met up with recently, which is staggering. Really not prepared for everything at sea. They've become mariners. They should become good, well-equipped mariners.
And tell me how you benefit from being a member of the Cruising Association.
Oh, wow. I spent so long in the library getting ready for our first, getting the first Nereida picked up and going on a cruise all around Scandinavia. It was wonderful. Every Wednesday evening for weeks on end, I'd go over to Limehouse and sit there and in the library and just get on with my route planning. It was a wonderful resource. And then, of course, meeting people in the regular meetings.
Yes, meeting people. I get the sense that sailing for you is not about being alone at sea. It's about the people you meet as well.
That's right. Yeah, I mean, again, on my non-stops, I'd be on the radio to prompt people, say, in South Africa, one of whom I might have already met, or when they tell me where they're from, Langebaan or wherever, Fishhook. Oh, I know there. I've been there, you know. So a lot of people that I meet, even by radio or by email, I've been to those places. You know, it's not just been about non-stops for me. It's been about stopping in places and meeting up with people, which is wonderful.
You mentioned your childhood, going through bomb sites, that you lived in an orphanage for a while. Do you think that that has given you your resilience in life?
Quite likely, I suppose. Although I think probably, you know, my determination to kind of see things to an end, to resolve them, is a bit genetic, maybe, I don't know, but I'm not really into genes, but I think it has to have done, right? Because I found out quite early on in life that I wanted something to happen, I had to make it happen. So I think that was a pretty important thing to have learned from an early life. And also, I suppose not having the caring and the hugging and the loving that one gets normally as a little kid, you know, from 3 to 9. I'm a very sociable person, I'm a very caring person, but that's probably only come out more later on in life than certainly not when I was younger.
I can see why you like the sailing community there, where there is that, you get enveloped by a giant, like, cruiser community hug, don't you?
Exactly. Yeah, in fact, actually, there's one thing. When I kept meeting up with some of my cruiser friends, the first thing we did was give each other a big bear hug, you know, because we've not met for some time and it's really nice to see each other again. And we've got so many shared experiences, you know, and that's the thing about the cruising life as well. Even though you might not have been in a place with a given set of people, when you meet up with them, you have that shared experience of those places and the weather and what happened to you. And yeah, and breakages. Everyone has breakages on a boat. Everyone has a job list, right? So, you know, there's no boat in the world without a job list. So you always have shared experiences.
You must have met some fascinating sailors during your years. Can you tell us about them and who you've met?
Well, actually, I met Ella MacArthur at Buckingham Palace in December of 2012, I think it was, because we'd been invited as adventurers to some big event, and Alex Whitworth of Berry Miller was there as well. And I saw Sam Davies. I made a beeline for Ellen to have a quick word with her, and Sam Davies was there. So that was quite something for me. And then more recently, when I was trapped in Australia, we had a coffee morning with Jessica Watson, and I met up with Lisa Blair, went into her boat and peeked through her glass dome, her Perspex dome. And then I also met up with Bill Hatfield, who of course has not long got back after his non-stop around, and was very pleased to be able to tell him, Bill, you know, I'm really happy that you did what you did, but I was also really happy to see you didn't go around those last two capes, because you've left me with an oldest person record of going around the world by the 5 great capes non-stop.
Brilliant.
I didn't quite meet up with, I nearly met up with John Sanders, but every time we were always on the wrong side of Australia. So he's the one person I've not yet met up with, but a lot of other people I have, yeah. Oh, Kay Cotty I've met up with when I was in Australia, mm-hmm. Went and stayed with her. And in fact, she was suggesting when I get to Australia, we go around and do a circumnavigation of Australia together.
Yeah, that sounds amazing. Are you going to take her up on the offer?
Well, I'm not sure it'll happen. In fact, it's not that easy going around Australia, but with the weather and cyclone season and all the rest of it in the Torres Strait. But but I enjoyed my time with her. You know, we had a lot to chat about. Obviously, I saw her twice while I was there, which is great.
On behalf of the Cruising Association and Practical Boat Owner magazine, a massive thank you goes to Jeanne for a fascinating insight into her cruising life and the challenges that she has overcome during her record-breaking voyages, something for us all to learn.
Well, thank you very much. It's a pleasure for me to be. Normally, I try to get to the September boat show, but I'm going to be on a little island called New Way probably at that time. But it's something I really enjoy, and I'm pleased to be there virtually at least.